During the Second World War, Papua New Guinea was a huge battleground. The Japanese came through and occupied a lot of Papua New Guinea. So consequently, there's a lot of stuff left here on the island. We're gonna go in and see a submarine base right now.
There was an old man there, and his father and his grandfather helped build the tunnels. George was his name, and he was just full of information.
So you say it drops 300 meters.
Yeah.
But the submarines would come up here, tie up to these things, and then load up with bombs and all the ammunition, everything. So we just go in here.
Yeah, you know.
And how far does it go back?
In and out.
Oh, it goes in and out?
Yeah.
How old were you when they were doing this?
I was at 14 years.
14?
Yeah.
Oh, so you remember it pretty well.
I can speak a little bit Japanese language.
Oh. Arigato gozaimasu.
Yeah, arigato gozaimasu.
I know a little bit of Japanese, very, very little. Very little.
Tanura, Japanese tanura. Tanura means tunnel.
How long did it take to build this?
Tanura.
3 or 4 months, you said?
Yeah.
How many people would actually live down here?
Well, 1,000.
Thousands?
1,000.
Wow.
They would have had native slaves or prisoners digging this out by hand.
Yeah, you can see here, look at the
pick marks.
Pick marks all the way through.
You have to do this all by hand, you're a slave in your own backyard. And then after the war ends, then you just keep having repetitive problems with the volcano. These people have to endure a lot, don't they?
It's so important to find those people, the eyewitnesses. There's so many stories that are untold. Just to sit down with somebody who experienced it when they were young and get their impression of what happened here in Papua, to me, that'll stick in my mind a lot more than anything I could ever read. He was saying that during the day, this was always getting bombed. His uncle got killed by a bomb. And then at night, the bombs would stop. And then that's when they would bring up the submarines and then they'd load them up. And he said it was really, really quick.
See, I lost World War II.
The Japanese do that?
Yeah.
They cut off your toe?
Yep.
It's always better to be here, to be on the spot. Like I could throw stones on a submarine if I was here 60 some odd years ago. That's how close they brought them. And there would have been Japanese Zeros flying overhead. My grandpa had books after the war that he picked up, all about the Second World War that my dad gave to me. I used to read them all the time. There's something about looking at these black and white pictures that always makes it seem like it was so long ago. But you come here and everything's in color and in 3D, and basically what to me as a kid was a storybook, this really interesting storybook, kind of come to life. It's the next best thing to being able to have a time machine. I still just can't get over the scenery and everything from up here. I mean, this is the perfect spot to have a $1 million cottage anywhere else in the world. And that was where some of the most bloody battles in World War II happened. Down on a second level, deep inside one of the bunkers here, you can still see Japanese newspapers that have been stuck to the roof. This is a pretty crudely chopped out gun emplacement. The beauty part about this, you get to see the best example of how small that reef goes out from the coastline and how abrupt that huge wall is dropping down a few hundred meters.
Devices should now be turned off and stowed as they may interfere with the aircraft's navigational and communication systems.